Does anybody remember the site in Posh Code by chance? There's a site called Posh Code that was around for a long time that had PowerShell scripts in it that you could search and find different snippets of code. Joel Bennett put it together and it was out in the wild, so to speak, and it was a site that he had. Well, anyway, I'm working with him on a new site that will actually have a link to all the videos that we've had here that we've actually published, and all the videos for any user group, as well as all the summit videos, where you can go to one website and you can find almost all the videos for anything PowerShell related. So if you're looking for something on modules, or you're looking for something on whatever it is you're looking for, and you're looking for the video of it, you should be able to come to one site and it'll take you to the direct YouTube link for it. So I built the initial rough draft, if you will, and so polished it up, and we're getting it put together so that everybody in the community can read it. Are you guys ready? Is it your, you ready to record yet? You ready?
It's kind of past two.
Okay, well, welcome to AZ PowerShell for August. This August, isn't it? August 7th.
Put my calendar.
28th, okay. Wow, I can't always, when I put myself on the spot, I'll remember everything. So, I'm Tom Schumacher. I actually have been leading this group for about almost 3 years. 3 years in November. And this week, or this month, we're pleased to have Tom Town from, I forget what company you're from.
That it changes all the time.
Okay.
It's a healthcare portion of Cognizant, which is a big, huge global, probably a competitor to our hosts here. But, so we won't talk too much about the company. We'll just say we're the healthcare arm. We sell commercial healthcare systems.
So okay. Insurance companies. Okay, and he's going to be talking to us today about how he's used PowerShell in our commercial application. But before we hand the floor over to Tom, I'd like to hand the floor over to our sponsor. The sponsor was every PowerShell Saturday we've had, the last few of them that we've done, as well as almost every event that we've had except for the very first one, which is the people that have on this room, Texas. So, wait, to you, Dan.
Thank you very much. Been sponsoring the group for a long time. Love it. I think it's awesome. Just want to help support you guys, learn as much as we can, and any way I can help, you know what I mean? So if it is just offering the room or ordering food or whatever it may be. But we're a huge company, 110 offices across the whole nation. So if you guys have friends anywhere that are looking for help, whether it's just resume advice or local market trends about kind of what's going on, what companies are hiring, if you're in this skill set, how much money you should be asking for when you're negotiating, anything like that, we can help with everything. Don't like to bombard you with job openings, specific job openings too much, but if we do see some good ones, we'll definitely lay them out here. So I don't want to take too much time. Send it on back to Tom and just let you guys have at it. So thanks.
Thank you.
This Tom, not this Tom. Yeah. Or Tom, maybe.
Hey Tom. Pick one. All right, so as I kind of said, part of a healthcare group within a larger organization, gone through some name changes. Originally called QCSI, Quality Care Solutions Incorporated. It's a company that was started somewhere, I think, in the late 80s or early 90s here in Phoenix. It was purchased by another company called Trizetto, which was then purchased by another company called Cognizant. So Cognizant is a bigger entity, is like 220,000 employees of consultants, right, around the globe. And our little niche in our space is about, 2,000, 3,000 employees maybe within the Trizetto or what used to be the Trizetto family. And all of us are focused on developing, supporting enterprise kind of class systems or pieces that go into an enterprise class system for running a health insurance company. The product that myself and Matt M and Dan and Anthony, who's here, and Matt G, which you've met before. And I don't know if Austin's online watching the live stream to heckle or not, but Austin worked with us until just last week, and he's now working remote from Salt Lake City, Utah. And so he was an integral part of all of this, so hopefully he'll watch from recording or something. But by and large, our product is a run your health insurance business. Blue Cross Blue Shield organizations, Aetna, you know, Cigna, those kinds of companies. We may not run every part of their business, but we have some application running in their business. But smaller insurance companies, our application will do everything from bill for premiums to accept the claims, determine how it's paid, manage all the provider contracts to determine which providers get paid which fees and what levels, and all those kinds of things, what kind of discounts take place. If you look at your own health insurance, you may have deductibles or stop loss, or you may have maximum out-of-pocket limits and things like that. This system takes care of calculating all of those kinds of things, and it does it for regions of the country. So, you know, in Phoenix Metro, you may be paying doctors higher than you might be paying folks in, say, Prescott or something like that. So it's really a full-scale kind of enterprise class system. There are other parts that come into play, but I won't talk too much about the product, but just to give you an idea, from our perspective, we have somewhere around, I don't know, 15 or 18 million lines of code in our application, a number of modules. It's a primarily a web app-based type application, so it runs under IIS on Windows, uses SQL Server, uses .NET, a full framework. I have to say that now because now everybody's talking, especially with Microsoft, about .NET Core framework and all of the .core stuff. So we still run under .NET framework. Much of our application was written a long time ago, so it runs under legacy WinForms. But we've started to migrate some of our functionality to run within Angular and TypeScript and use some of the more HTML5 modern types of capabilities, things like that. So I'm not really going to run the application. Our area that we're going to talk about today, or I'm going to talk about today, really focuses on what happens before installation, what happens during installation, and what happens after installation from a DevOps kind of perspective. So PowerShell is kind of Microsoft's DevOps language. So we have written a bunch of PowerShell over the last 6 months. Some of it was written before that and refined. But we've written a bunch of PowerShell within our product team over the last 6 months that help our clients figure out whether they've got everything in place to install the application successfully, to install the application, and then make sure it's running successfully and everything after installation is still the way it should be, in case 6 months or a year or 2 years later, somebody comes along and deletes a file or changes something that they shouldn't have changed. So we call this module our QNext DevOps module. Our product is called QNext. And I don't know if there's any questions about the scope of things or what we're going to talk about, but I can just dive right in, and then you can see some of the stuff that we've been doing. And certainly welcome all kinds of feedback, too, because nobody in our product space that we know of has put something like this together. None of our other products within our family of products really has anything like this. They've been using it more internally for internal deployments and internal management and administration, things like that. So we're forging a lot of new ground, or have forged a lot of new ground, and we certainly recognize that we haven't necessarily got it right the first time. And so we welcome any kind of input and feedback. Unfortunately, I can't post our code because it's all proprietary, and if I wanted to, it'd probably take me a year to get our lawyers to allow me to do that. So, but I'll answer any questions, I'll show you some code, and then we'll go from there. Certainly, if there's some things that you're trying to do in your organization that this might be a benefit, maybe we can find ways to get you some snippets of code or something like that to help out and replicate some of the things we've done. So as I mentioned, our product is pretty large. I'll show this because I can zoom in on it. We've got 8 different programs that you would use to install our application. All but one is an MSI, so we're using kind of the legacy MSI technology. We've used it forever. That's just the way it, you bring it up, it asks you a bunch of questions, and then it starts dropping files and changing configuration, setting up Windows services, setting up websites and web apps and things like that, app tools. So not all of our clients use all 8 of those components, but most of our clients use at least 2 or 3 or 4. So getting the installation correct and putting things in the right order and being consistent about it isn't necessarily the easiest thing at times. And when you, historically, when you've upgraded our application, you had to completely uninstall the application and then reinstall it with a new version. Over the last year, we've done a lot to allow you to just apply the changes. So what we call a cumulative upgrade. So you can just run the new installers on top of what's already there, and it will take the configuration that existed and reuse that and just put the new files or the different files in. So we're doing a lot for our clients to help streamline that, to help make sure they don't have to remember what they answered, you know, possibly 2 or 3 years ago. Our clients don't typically update every time we ship a release. So most of our clients are somewhere in the neighborhood of 18 months to 24 months behind the releases that we ship. We ship a release every quarter. One time we shipped a release every 2 weeks. Another time we shipped a release every 8 weeks. We finally settled on every quarter, and still might still take every release. So it does take a while for people to upgrade their site. And some sites have 6 or 8 data centers with different regions that they've got to update as well. So it does take some time. So what we've tried to do is streamline this whole process, make it a shorter process, and make it more error-free. Let's get rid of this. So one of the first things our clients have to do is figure out what are the prerequisites for installing our software. And we have a whole host of things, right? What version of our software is compatible with what version of Windows Server OS? What version is compatible with .NET? What version of SQL Server do we support in a particular version? And so our clients typically go to our customer exchange site, which is our customer support site. And for each product, we have what's called a compatibility matrix. So historically, this has been where they go to figure all this stuff out. And it's not exactly the greatest thing, but I'll give you just a hint, and then I'll show you later on how we've made it a lot easier. We pick a version of our product, and we get the matrix. And now we can scroll through pages and pages of prerequisites that are required for a particular version of our product. So some of these are our sister products. Down at the bottom we have what version of Windows, what version of SQL Server, what version of Office we're compatible with. There's the database. So it's a lot of manual effort, a lot of, you know, sifting through things. And then each of the major components may have different requirements. They have a separate set of requirements. Most of them overlap, like we don't support SQL 2008 and SQL 2012 on one component, and SQL 2016, SQL 2017 on another component. Those things overlap, but there may be other prerequisites for different components. So it's a pretty complex process to figure out what you need and how to get ready for that. So I'm not sure if we're going to be able to see this very well, but when we ship our product, we have our set of installers, which is this installation folder. And then we also ship silent install files that are just basically text INI files that allow you to redefine what the answers to the prompts would be and run them in a silent mode. But we are also now shipping a separate folder within the zip file package that a client would get that are our PowerShell modules. And at the very top, we call this QNX.DevOps. So this module, QNX.DevOps, is actually a series of modules. when you get into it. So we have a bunch of subordinate modules. And we really can't see very well here, but basically what we have here is a qnext.devops.installation module, qnext.devops server information, qnext.devops.server requirements, qnext.devops.ui, and we do have a UI. We built a PowerShell UI, so not everything is command line driven, but everything that you can do in the UI, you can do in the command line, and then there's a few extra things that you can do in the command line. So we tried to make it very user-friendly and people to transition from a point-and-click kind of experience into more of a what you would call a DevOps experience, where it's all driven by commands that you can script and things like that. So, and then we also have a utilities folder or a utilities module, so that all of our kind of common things that would run across those other modules are built into the utilities area. And if you dive down into some of these, you'll see there's submodules. So we've got another module called DevOps logging. We've got a DevOps configuration. And then within each area, we've got a source folder, and we may have classes, formats, and functions folders. And so we have developed this in combination using not just PowerShell functions or commandlets, but we've also built in some areas using PowerShell classes that look very much like a C# class. So with PowerShell 5 and above, and we require PowerShell 5.1 for our installation and support for these releases. You have a question?
Oh, no.
You're just, okay. Yeah. So within our functions, you know, we'll have PS1 files. This particular module I don't think has a class, but if we go into the server information and look at the source there, we have a number of classes that we've built. So in this particular folder, there's 24 classes. And that's really a brains of one aspect of what we're doing. So what do we have to do when we ship this to clients? Is clients will have to actually get the module files out of our zip file, and then they'll have to copy them to a location that they can then use to import into PowerShell. Or they can set up their PS module path, put them in a folder within PS module path, and they'll automatically be available, so you don't have to copy them on a regular basis, especially since if people use one version of our application for 2 years, you're not going to want to copy these every time you go in and want to try to use one of these functions or these commandlets. So our recommendation is just to have clients copy these to their PS module path, and then if you want to, you can automatically put the import statement in, but our installation experience for this is just copy the files and import the module. So if we import the module here, it will then take that top level name, that qnext.devops, and go and traverse all of the submodules, however deep they go, and it will pull all those in because we've defined the nested modules within each module and submodule so that it knows. Now, our application or our installation experience really needs to run as an administrator. So I've opened up PowerShell as an administrator in an administrator mode. So you'll see that I'm using administrator mode, but it's only because all of our installation processes require that type of experience or that type of level of security or privilege to do things. Many of our modules don't require that, but one thing that got us partway through our development is you can in PowerShell say a particular function or a particular module requires administrator level access and embed that in a comment line. But if you do that and you have nested modules like this, it expects that regardless of what you're importing, that you have administrator level access to just import any of them because they're so interconnected. So you want to keep that in mind. If you do require some level of administrator access within your modules, if you build out modules and use those, that any nesting of that will require that administrator access for everything that's in that whole hierarchy of modules. And so we've kind of worked around that by not defining that at that level, although it's nice and easy, Wherever we need administrator access, we've created a function that will allow, we can call to find out, are we running as an administrator or not? And then we'll display the appropriate message if we're not and we need to be. And so one of our utility functions is checking to see if you're a local administrator running in administrator mode. So that was one of our goals, is to make this as easy to deploy and install as possible. And so basically two commands get you there, as opposed to running potentially eight different MSIs to install our product. So our product has been very complex to install in the past. We wanted something that ran standalone without all this other plumbing in place. So one of the first things we tell clients is, get to the right screen here. So you can see I've got my copy command. So if I go ahead and just import my module, and I do a get module, all you'll really see, even though we've got a bunch of nested modules, is that one qnext.devops module. And then we versioned our module based upon our product version. And I'll show you a little bit more about that in a second. But if I can also look at all of the functions that are available, all of the commandlets that are available, you can see that we've got a host of those. So we can manage a list of predefined servers by adding servers or editing attributes of the server. We've got a bunch of get to get information. We've got a bunch of installation functions and modules, or functions and commands. We've got some that allow us to create new logs, new server configuration files. We've got ones to read messages that have been logged and read the server configuration. We can set that location as opposed to just create a brand new one. There's our test is admin. That's the way we test to see if it's running as a local administrator where we need to do that test. A bunch of other tests, and we can talk about a few of those, uninstalls. And then mostly we use these write qnext.devops message and write qnext.devops server config as our own internal modules, but clients could certainly use those directly if they wished. So I forget how many modules or functions that we've created. I think it's probably somewhere in the neighborhood about 25 or 30 as part of our process. And then, you know, much like anything else, if you just want to find certain commands, right, if you just want to understand where are the installation ones, you can filter by the name and just get the commands that within our modules that were associated with installation. The other thing we've done is we've embedded the built-in help into all of our modules and all of our functions. So if you do a get help, you'll see that you get a standard formatted help. So we do have within our product online documentation that clients can go look at our screens, find out what information needs to be put into a particular field on the screen. We didn't do that with the PowerShell modules because everything is just built into PowerShell. So all of our documentation that a client would use is built into the module and built into the functions. And we didn't copy that to our online documentation because we know over time things just get disconnected, right? Somebody forgets to cut and paste, somebody forgets to make an update, something like that. So you can use all of the standard, you know, dash examples, dash detail, dash full, and we tried to give our clients a good understanding of what they need to know to run one of these functions. And it'll even refer to other functions as well. And then we've also included a link to our online documentation, so you could cut and paste this. And the way we've documented things online, see if I can get a good copy of that link and then open up Chrome, over here to Chrome. We've tried to make the online documentation something that is more introductory, right? More of a why would I want to use this or how do I use this, especially we don't know whether our clients have experience. I'm going to our test area, not to our live area. So let me go back over here, go to our documentation, and go back. So we've tried to not just replicate things that are in the module or the function documentation. We've tried to actually provide them some scenario-based type of information. So if I wanted to do a test of prerequisites, what is required on a particular server, and does a server actually meet those prerequisites, we've gone through that process and created some summary level documentation for that. So then we talked about how to get started, importing the module, setting up the log file location. I'll show you that in a minute. And then in another place, we have actually videos that walk people through this process step by step so that they can watch videos and see how the process worked. But our documentation online is not a replication of that module documentation. So if we go back here, one of the things that we also liked about PowerShell was that you had the PowerShell version table. So it's clear the display down here. And so if you're familiar with this, it tells you what PowerShell version, it tells you the edition, compatible versions. It actually gives you a kind of an internal Microsoft build number, CLR version, those types of things. So since so many clients are running different versions of our product, we put something similar together and we call it the QNX version table. So from a support perspective, if somebody says, hey, I'm having a problem with this, now we know we've got an internal version number where we started at 1 for our first release. We've got a module version number which matches up exactly to the product version that this copy of the modules were shipped with. So every quarter we release a new release. So next quarter we'll have 5.50.005.000. So we'll know, hey, are you running the right version, doing the right comparisons? And that should be the target version of our product that you're trying to install or check for. Then we've got our own build version. Basically, it's a TFS build name with the highest change set that was part of that build, so that we can go back to a specific build. One of the things that we do is every 3 weeks, we have a sprint. We conduct our sprints in 3 week cycles. And then if you do the math, there's one extra week in there, and we have that week for kind of planning and retrospective and things like that. So each one of those 4 sprints within that quarter cycle, we also make available like an early copy of our release. And so we'll do that same thing with our DevOps module, and we'll be able to use that build number to know which sprint drop, as we call it, someone may be running or may be using. The module version won't change. The compatible versions at the bottom may change depending on how quickly we've updated the internal support of the things that we're going to check. And then the compatible versions just show, hey, this particular copy of the modules are compatible with 2 of our versions. And we do something really weird. We actually have the exact same source code base, and we built 2 different named versions out of that. Don't ask me why, don't ask me what, but we ship 2 actually different versions that are the same content, the same functionality. And so some clients like the comfort level of having that major minor version stay the same and not have to jump. And historically, when you've jumped a major minor we may have changed what operating systems we support or SQL Server versions. So historically, in their mind, they think that's a major change. I got to rebuild everything from the ground up on my servers. And so so we have our current version, which today is our 5.5 version that we shipped, and our one back, which is 5.4, and it makes people feel comfortable and feel like they don't have to do anything significant to do an upgrade. Although most of our clients have a lot of custom code, and it takes them, you know, anywhere from 6 to 24 weeks to actually plan and execute an upgrade, because there's so many interconnects, so many data feeds coming in, so many things coming out, that they've got to actually go and do all of the testing for that. So much custom code, they need to make sure that we haven't changed the database structure and schema that might break their code. So it does take a lot of time for them to do that, as opposed to just installing our product and doing it. So our next version that will come out will be in November, and it will support 5.60. It'll be a new major minor version, and so it'll support actually three major minor versions going back. And so we'll see another one here. The beauty of this is that we have a CI build that basically every time new code is checked in to our release branch, Matt G, who brought me the dongle and then left, he wrote that to actually embed all of this information into this next version table for object. So the thing that he did is it actually goes and reads some files that we have that have all of our configuration data as to what we're going to check, and evaluates regular expressions that are in there and comes up with that list of compatible versions at the bottom. So it's really kind of cool. He kind of downplayed it, but I thought it was kind of cool that he was actually reading our own checked in files to actually figure out what it's supporting and then generates this from that build. And that happens every time. And then he also wrote something that automatically provides the module files out to what we call a network share, that's our staging folders. So every time something's checked in, it gets copied to the staging folder for that current release. And then it's automatically available. We don't have to remember to copy stuff out of TFS and make it part of our package. It just happens. That's kind of cool. So if we go down, one of the first things we talk to clients about is actually creating this log file, and you can create these logs, and everything else that we do within our DevOps modules will be logged in some way. And so as long as you have a log file, we'll write to that log file. And in essence, what we're doing here is we're creating an environment variable, either at the system level or the user level. And we're assigning that environment variable to a file path. It may be a network file path, it may be a local file path, but we're assigning that. So then everything else that runs later on will actually look for that environment variable when it goes to write a message, and it will then find that log file or not find the log file, if the case may be, and it will go ahead and consolidate everything into one location if you want it, or one for each server if you want it. So for my purposes here and my demonstration, I'm just going to create a log file locally, and the force parameter will actually create a new file, much like other PowerShell commandlets. If you're setting something up and creating something new, it will give you an error if it finds that there's one that's already existing. So if we use the force, we'll actually get a new log file. So there's also set and get commands. So I can now get where is the log file, and it's telling me where I just told it was. Right? I don't have one set up at the user level, so when I run this, it just basically returns nothing. If there's one set up at the user level and the system level, we'll use the user setting and override whatever's in the system. And then we have a command line function that allows you to read what was in the log. So it returns an array of objects of all of the rows that, in essence, got written to the log. So we automatically generate a UTC date and time. We capture the computer name. We sometimes capture the IP address. That's not always consistent. We capture the user that was running these things. We capture a level for the log information. Is it information? Is it warning, error? So we basically mirror the PowerShell log levels. And then we have a message field. We have a key value pair for a message. And then we say what function was the one that caused this record to be written to the log. So we're actually pulling those things automatically. Everything here except for the message and the message key value pair is being pulled automatically by the function. And so if we look at the code for that, and my cursor. Do I need to zoom in? Can everybody see that? So you can see at the top, we've got all of our standard PowerShell comments for built-in function documentation. We're using advanced function templates to create these. So we've got commandlet binding, and that's important from our logging perspective. So here's this particular module is where we're creating the new file for logging. So we've got a set of parameters. We've got parameter sets. All right, is everybody familiar with what a parameter set means? Yeah, okay. So we're using those for the system and user, so you can only specify one or the other. You can override some things if you want. And then by and large, what we're doing here is we're looking for the log location. We're finding it. We're testing to see if we can actually write to that location. We can access that. So if it's on a network share, we'll test that. We can get to it or not. And then we're collecting some information. So down in here is the body of where we're getting the module name. So we're looking at the call stack within PowerShell to actually find what is the next level above this particular function that was running at the time this function was called. And then we add a kind of a primer message to the log. We set the UTC, the computer name, the IP address, the user, the log level, all the things that you saw on the screen when I ran the read log function. And we do implement try catches all over the place. So if there's any kind of exception, we're trying to catch those exceptions and signal to the user that something happened that we didn't expect. And then the write function does a lot of the same things as the new, although it's what actually does the write and of the data out to the log file. Now, something else we're using here is, since we're using all of the log levels that are the same as what PowerShell would use when it displays messages. So you have preference variables that allow you to set what do I want to have happen when a particular level of message is being written. So like you have write host, which kind of could care less about a log level, but you have other PowerShell functions built in, write error, write warning, write informational. And so you can set that in a preference variable and know what will happen by default. So if I look at, let's just come down here. I can do a dollar error preference, error action preference, and it'll show me that my current practice is to continue. Okay? I can do a information preference, and it'll be silently continue. So if you're not familiar with that, silently continue will not display that information message, but it will display an error message. So if I do a write information, you don't see anything come back to the console. But if I do a write error, you'll now see something show up on the console. So we allow our clients to set those preference variables however they want to, and they can see interactively information level messages, warning level messages, however they want to set those, but they'll always be logged into our log file, and they can come back and interrogate those so that we haven't lost that information. So that's one of the things that was real important to us, is to make sure that anything we do, we write some level of log information, and that it's persisted as long as the client wants it to be persisted. But you can also see things as they show up.
That's awfully
kind of you. So just to give you a sample of our interactive experience, I've shown you a handful of commands. We have a command that show QNext DevOps utility. And when you run that, it actually brings up a screen. And unfortunately, you can't see it very well. But it will bring up a screen where there's a tab on here that allows you to go interrogate the log.
Did you guys write that in PowerShell Studio?
This particular portion we did not write in PowerShell Studio. It was just written using the .NET classes. We have another section that was written in PowerShell Studio, and that makes it a lot easier, for sure. So you have the ability to display the logs, and you can filter the logs by whatever log level, a span of a date and time, a particular computer name or IP address, or whatever message value that may be there, or message key. So we give you that capability, and then if there's more than 1,000 messages that might be returned, you'll be able to page through those. You won't actually have to wait until we just pull up 10,000 messages and let you sit there spinning. We'll do those, I think it's 100 or 1,000 at a time. We'll bring back and allow you to page and scroll through that page, and then we'll bring up some pagination controls on the screen that allow you to see that. So I thought it was kind of cool that, while it looks like the Battleship Gray kind of, you know, old style DB application, we did put some interactive user experience in our modules as well. Any questions? Anything? Yeah.
How many people are modifying these modules?
We had at the time over the last 6 months, we had two Scrum teams working on this, and there were six developers, I think, developing. Actually, there's two Scrum teams and one extra person on another Scrum team. So there's about six people, and all of the code's checked in and managed by TFS. And like I said, we've got that CI build that actually goes through and processes everything. Now, we actually have a releasable branch and then a dev branch, and our process is check it into dev, make sure nothing blows up or breaks, and test it out there before you merge it into the main releasable branch, and then the releasable branch is the one that gets staged for internal QA testing and things like that.
Now, do you use continuous delivery too, or are you just continuous integration?
So we have some continuous delivery. So from the PowerShell standpoint, there's really no delivery. The delivery is staging the modules. So in essence, there's like, I'm not going to go deploy this on a server and then do something with that server, because it's all of the things that you would do before you deploy. But for our product where we have the web app and everything built in. We actually do a combination of semi-manual delivery and some automated delivery. So we have multiple QA server sets that get installed every build that we have. And we typically schedule a couple of builds a day. One of those builds we don't necessarily install, but one of those builds we install for sure. And then anytime a team needs one that's installed, they can either run the build that automatically gets installed on one server set, or they can ask for an update of another server set from the last good build. So our build process for our whole product actually builds the whole product, stages all the installers, stages all the other files that are associated with it automatically into that staging area, just like the PowerShell modules get staged. And then we have one server set that automatically gets installed. So it will go and uninstall the product, reboot the servers, make sure they're clean, and then it'll start the installation process with predefined parameters to say, here's how we want this installation configured. And then when it's done, it reboots the servers to make sure everything's clean and comes back up. And then it sends out a message automatically to all of the folks that do testing or use those testing servers to let them know, hey, an update has been made. It also sends out a message beforehand to say, hey, we're starting this update on this set of servers. So it gives everybody a warning, and then it goes through the process, and then when it's finished, it lets them know.
Are those servers virtual?
Yeah, they're all virtual.
Are you building them every single time?
No, we don't build them from scratch every single time. We have servers that we predefine every time we change something significant, and we use VMware. We have catalog items, kind of gold images, basically, that we, when we need a new server set, we have a particular catalog item for each type of server that we need to spin up in that server set, and we use those, and then make any small slight adjustments after those have been provisioned, and then we can start using those to actually deploy. So we don't go that far, but we don't, internally we have some, let's just say, challenges with us being allowed to do certain things within the virtual environment that we would want to do that. It would be great because we could probably make more efficient use of the physical hardware supporting the virtual environment. But in our business, and because there's potential, although there's very slight potential in the development environment, there's potential that there could be personally identifiable information or personal health information that somehow makes its way into our development environment. We apply some, not necessarily all, but some of the same security restrictions of what people can do, even people with administrator level access within that environment. So
when you talked about you have like two different teams of developers working on the product, that was teams of like .NET developers, or is that PowerShell people? Or
they're Scrum teams, and so some people have .NET, C# experience, and some people don't. Some people are pretty much what we would call DevOps system engineers,
okay.
And they've been focused on PowerShell, or they've been focused on system administration or something like that. They've learned PowerShell and become a developer, right? In essence, a developer of PowerShell.
Right.
And then some people we cross-trained from C# and brought them over to do PowerShell development. And it was pretty easy considering that PowerShell, since it's based on .NET, there's a whole lot of similarities there. Yeah.
So then when it comes to your builds and that kind of thing, do you approach the, forgive me if I'm speaking out of turn, you already showed it. I have to step away a minute. But in any case, do you approach the building of your modules the same way that you build the .NET code?
Very much so. Only the module build takes a matter of seconds.
Right.
And our code build, actually, since we're building the whole application pretty much at this one time,
right,
it takes about 2.5 to 3.5 hours, just
okay.
One code build. So the cycle time for the DevOps stuff is quicker. We're not really doing a build. We're taking code, merging it from a dev branch to a release branch. And then automatically, when that code gets checked into the release branch, we trigger what, in essence, is a TFS vNext, as we call it.
Yeah.
It's a more modern TFS build,
yeah.
A CI build, that then says, okay, anything that's changed in these areas, it will go collect all that stuff. It will massage those files just a little bit to inject a version number and a build number and things like that. So a minute ago, I showed how we have a QNext version table, much like the PS version table.
And it builds
so it builds this information and makes sure that this is all correct, right, within that. And so that CI process then, once it's made the changes to those files, it actually copies them to a network share that we call our staging area. And then the staging area is used to actually package up the product when we're ready to package it out.
Okay, and then when you're talking about the individual functions, do you deal with them on an individual file basis and then amalgamate them together in a module? Or can you speak to any of that? You know what I mean?
Yeah, so a little bit, you're not going to be able to see it real well, but we break things down.
So that's the individual functions that are in those modules, right?
So this is actually a classes folder.
Okay.
So within each module, we have a source folder. Within each source folder, we break things down into classes, formats, and functions.
So
your actual PowerShell functions are here,
okay,
right, in the functions. The classes, and we're actually creating PowerShell classes for a good portion of our stuff.
So you're depending on 5.0 for sure then.
5.1 is what we require.
Okay.
And then we discovered this formats so that there's a way to, by default, display the information coming out of your functions in a certain format. And that's basically, I think it's an XML file, right? None of the guys here in the room know.
Yeah.
It's Austin and Andrew worked on that, and Andrew couldn't be here. I don't know if Austin's online, whether he can shake his head or not. I don't see who's online.
And so that is that all the functions or just a single function?
No, we've got multiple modules nested. So we've got a top-level module we call QNext DevOps.
Okay.
And then we've got a layer of modules underneath that. And then within that, we've got a layer of modules potentially, not in this one, but so in here... I'm not picking a good one. Utilities, we've got other modules within that, a logging module, configuration module. So we use, in the PSD1 file, we have the nested modules that we fill in for all the things that this particular node of this module tree is built into.
Cool.
So, yeah.
Did you already go over this?
A little bit, yeah.
Sorry. Cool stuff.
Okay.
And then I assume you find it easier when you have individual files for each developer to work on their own file as opposed to a big monolithic file.
Yeah, we've set as our development standard, one class goes in one class file, one module, one function goes into one file.
Yeah.
For the most part, I mean, if there's some localized, functions that just assist just that one manlet or function, then it stays within that function file, right, that PS1 file. But by and large, we tried to separate it out that way so that it's easy to find information, right? So if I had one big class file and I had 24 classes, it doesn't matter how many people I may have working on it. I don't want to have to sift through a couple thousand lines of code to find the one class definition that I'm looking for to change or check, right?
Yeah,
so that's how we've broken it down.
Nice.
And there's probably better ways. There's other ways for sure, but that's just the way we
kind of... Well, it's cool because when you get beyond just yourself, then you'll understand why things are done that way.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. All right. So let's pop back. So we were talking kind of where we got here, much like surfing the net, we kind of got off at a bunch of different tangents. So where we got here was looking at our write message. And as I mentioned, this will respect the preference variables. So every message we create our object to write or get back to that point. So the log message will include members. And then when we actually go to write the file, I can find my cursor. There it is. So down here we make sure the file exists, right? If we can't find the file at the log path, maybe somebody deleted it after they created the file or set it up. And then we do something really interesting. Because we can have multiple people on the same server writing to the log at the same time, multiple, we we haven't done the complete job yet, but we've at least tried to come up with a solution. Because so in a single server or in a network share, if you're writing your log, when PowerShell just by default opens a file, and we're actually serializing and deserializing a CSV object for all of our log records, we're not just writing plain text. So it is, when you read it back in, it's an object. And so when you serialize and deserialize and open that file to put something out there, Windows locks that file, so nobody else can get into that file. And so we don't want to just always return an error just because we can't write the log file. So we've used .NET mutex at the computer level, and you can define these mutexes at a process level or at a system level.
So that's a .NET class right there?
So this is not a .NET class, but we're using a .NET class.
It's the mutex,
right? The threading.mutex class. And we're instantiating a new instance of that into the mutex variable.
Yep.
And then the mutex will check to see if somebody else already has control of that.
If the file's already open.
Yep. And if it does, then it'll wait, right? And retry. And it'll do that,
up to 100, is that what that means?
It actually,
like,
yeah.
100 milliseconds?
I think that's a 100 milliseconds there.
Okay.
And then it will set a wait time inside here, inside this loop at 50.
Yeah.
Right? And then eventually it'll say, I give up.
Okay.
But we've got a couple of different things that are working in addition to the mutex. We're also doing some things to kind of check how many times do we go through this process, and if it's too many times, we'll just give up eventually. We're not going to try forever and hold up whatever the user's doing in their PowerShell session, right? So down here, we're saying, hey, we're unable to acquire a lock to write to the log file. Here's the path we were trying to like to write to, right?
I assume that's a .NET class. Are you like pulling those classes into one? That threading.mutex. You're adding that type in somewhere.
Because we require full .NET framework to be installed.
And that's a rush. You can pull into threading.mutex.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Cool. Good note there. Thank you.
Yep. So that was one of the tricky things we ran into with this. And then we have some kind of unauthorized access exception. So we're fully using the power of the try-catch. Right. And then what we're also doing here to overcome this two-hop kind of problem with PowerShell. So I don't know if everybody's aware of this, but if you are on one machine and you say, go remotely run something on another machine, and that tries to write to something that is then controlled by a third machine, it's very complex to make that work correctly. Let me just say that. It's not impossible. It's very complex. So one of the things that we did to get around this is we actually, when we run this write message, it's actually running on whatever server the log file is actually physically on. So if it's a network share, it goes and opens up a connection, it imports the module automatically behind the scenes,
oh, cool.
And then runs the right message with the right parameters, and then shuts down that remote session. So when we go and interrogate, like to check to see if requirements are present on a second server, so it could be run on my laptop and I say go check this server, it's actually pushing that module, set of module files out to that second machine. It is then saying, where is my log file configured from the second machine, not from my machine, but where's the log file configured? And then it will go to the third machine potentially and push some things out there to actually write and overcome that two-hop kind of problem.
So the executing machine is the one that actually does that invoke command?
The one that is actually going to try to write the message will look for where is the message file located and execute the right message on that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
So that's why You know, we've got a script block and we do all kinds of funky stuff up in here with the credential. We pass along the credential, those kinds of things. So it becomes, in essence, a two hop instead of the three hop. And then down here is where we actually will go ahead and write things to the screen. And if all of that has run and run successfully, we'll, depending on whether it's an error warning, info, or debug, we'll issue the appropriate command. And then based upon your PowerShell preference variables, or you can override these things at using common parameters on the PowerShell command, because we're using the abatance functions and the command binding. You can override those as well at the command level instead of setting the preference variables, which we did have to investigate that and understand how that all worked. We thought it worked a little differently, and there are some quirks about that, but by and large, it works pretty good. But the key takeaway from being able to use those preference variables and be able to use the common parameters is that either all of your modules, and by default, we set a standard to say, make all of our modules, embed commandlet bind in all of our modules. But if the top level module, the first one you call, has that binding, and then a sub function that you call does not, it passes that context on to that sub function. So you can use the common parameters and whatever else you would normally use. But if the first level function that you call doesn't have that, the secondaries won't respect those common parameters and things like that coming from the first level function that you call. So that was kind of the lesson learned along the way as well.
Wow. How long has it taken you guys to do this? A couple of years?
6 months, actually.
Really?
And you've only seen the tip of the iceberg.
Well, I'm sure of that. And how that goes.
So, all right, so that's the logging. I'm not going to get into detail, but suffice it to say that we're basically, people can define different servers, and within a QNX installation, typically there's about five or six servers for one environment, including a SQL Server box, what we call our framework or our distribution hub box, and we have multiple what we call execution units and app servers and things like that will distribute the website load, like through an L5 load balancer or something like that, or our API calls. So we have RESTful APIs, as well as several other different variations of architecture of APIs, because this thing's been out there for, 20 years or something like that, plus. The way you can define these server types, or you can override at the command level and say, I want to test this server for a particular server type. And different server types, by and large right now, but in the future may be different, by and large, we have the same requirements. I have to be on a certain version of Windows. I have to have certain things installed. I have to have certain folders predefined. I have to have roles and features within Windows Server set up a certain way. So when I showed you the compatibility matrix before, so let's pop over.
If any of those like shoulds and that kind of stuff, are you using DSC for any of it?
We're not using DSC for anything.
Oh, you're not?
Okay. We played with DSC to us for what we're trying to do. And because we're in an environment that we don't really have full understanding and knowledge and control over, we basically avoided the whole DSC and trying to interrogate the system logs to try to figure out what went on. Didn't go on, all that kind of stuff.
Gotcha.
So we don't actually...
It's usually easier to roll your own, is what you're saying.
Within our stuff, we don't actually affect configuration. We don't go and install something that's missing. We're just going to tell users what's not there, what's not set correctly. If I can squint enough, I'll have to see whether I'm on the right VM. Because I've got a couple of...
It says.
Yeah, I don't think I'm on the right one. So let me pop over to the other one. And I'm using, I don't know if you've ever used Remote Desktop Manager, but it's really kind of great. It's an old thing, but it's really nice to be able to reconnect and automatically connect to things. So you know, wonderful compatibility matrix that you saw. We've kind of reduced it down and actually added more detail to be basically one command that you can run on a particular server and see if you've got everything that you need from our perspective. So you know, we've got to import the module. Thought I highlighted it and said import. There we go. And then we can say, get the requirements. So in essence, show me what would be in the compatibility matrix plus all these other details. So if you do that, you'll get a whole host of output. And it goes into varying levels of detail. If we kind of go back to the top, you'll see some of the more basic checks that we do. So we're checking the operating system. So our requirement is either Windows Server 2012 R2 or 2016. And then for different server types, it can be different, right? We've got that in there. What version of our product? So this is our first iteration. It's with our 5.5.4 version. It's a pre-installation, so we do some pre-installation checks, and we do some post-installation checks to make sure things got deployed correctly or things are still in a state that things should work. And again, for each one of these items, we've got this reference that you can cut and paste and go plug into our customer exchange site and go to some of the more higher level general documentation. So if I'm on a server, I can say, you know, get the requirements for pre-installation, and I'll just make it nicer to read, and I'll open it up in a grid view. So again, it's tough to see, but I don't think I can zoom in on this. Oh, I can. All right, fantastic. Let me expand this.
What do you have about the reference material for this? Is it on you referencing the web page that you updated, or you have like a
no? We
like
have
a table like somehow built.
It's very simple. And I'll show you. It's basically a CSV file that we maintain in Excel.
All right.
With this information. And I'll show you what that looks like. We'll go open that up. But for each thing we're going to check, we've got a component group, or for like the operating system, some of the base information, we don't have a component group. We have a precondition. So if you're running on 2012 R2 versus on 2016, your IIS version might be different, right? Because 2016 doesn't support IIS version 8.5. 2012 R2 doesn't have a way of installing IIS version 10. So we've got some dynamically changing tests that happen based upon other situations or other conditions that we've discovered about the test. This is pretty much all of our server types is IIS and PowerShell. As we said, PowerShell version 5.1 is our requirement there, our operating system. So you got server types out here to the right, and if you scroll out, you know, we've got a long list, and then we've got our reference link there as well. So for one of our server types where we actually process electronic HIPAA transactions, we require BizTalk, and it takes those standard format, if you want to call a HIPAA transaction a standard format. If you've ever seen one, You don't want to see one. So it's a governmental, you know, standards body way of saying here's how to define electronic information, and it's by and large a here's all the different ways you can define it, and then you and your trading partner can decide how you want that to be. So it's not necessarily a set standard. It's here's a bunch of stuff. Some of it's required, and some of it's required situationally, and some of it's not required at all, but maybe required because of who you're talking to or who's getting it.
So not HL7, that's that type of format,
it's,
right?
It's actually worse and better, yeah, if you want to call it better. It was the next generation of HL7. So these are ANSI X12 transaction types is basically what these are. And within ANSI X12, there's all kinds of transaction types. So financial institutions have a segment of transaction types. Manufacturers have a set of transaction types with their suppliers so that all of these transactions can happen electronically in a quote unquote standard format. And like I say, if you go and you start diving into this, I mean, these are just one particular transaction type is hundreds of pages of documentation, just one. And that's not a set, that's not all of them, that's just one. And it gets down to a very detailed level, which is great because it gives you a lot of information, but it also has so much information in there that there's a lot of confusion understanding what's there and what's not. But there's an internal textual format that all of this information gets translated into and out of, and BizTalk has that built into it. And way back when somebody decided that we were using BizTalk versus, you know, something from a company that used to be called Mercator or something else that would actually translate those electronic transaction files and turn them into something that's, well, we turn it into basically XML or XML format that can then be turned into objects. But by and large, it was the best way at the time. And BizTalk is kind of a thorn in our side, but we still use it. So so for our Connect server type, we require BizTalk, but for no other server types do we require BizTalk. So then we also have access runtime because we do imports and exports out to access. And so we require a certain version of access. We have the distributed transaction coordinator needs to be set up a certain way on each server so that transactions across the whole server set, when they have to be coordinated, can be. We have some, these are more recommendations, but we actually check to see if clients allow certain event logs to be overwritten and are a certain size. We check to see if you have configured the firewall to be open or closed. And so all the servers that we run on require being part of a domain. They can't be standalone because they all have to integrate and talk to each other in a pretty detailed way. So we require that the public and private firewall be turned on. The domain firewall right now probably isn't the best setting, but we require that to be disabled because we haven't gotten through every kind of communication to be able to define it for the security folks. So we also, you know, require .NET 4.6 or higher. It's actually .NET 4.6.2, so there's several checks here for .NET for SQL Server. So if we're checking a SQL Server QNext server, where the SQL databases might be deployed, it requires a certain version of .NET, so we've translated that into our requirements. And we can go on and on. We've got roles and features. We've got, you know, for SQL Server, we require certain other things. We require certain desktop folders. For some of part of our code that we use, it uses open source, like from NuGet packages and stuff, so it requires a Visual C++ runtime. If you're running a QNext reports server, it requires SQL Server reporting services. So we've got a lot of these things built in, and it's a nice, consolidated, concise place to see what you need for a particular server type. And then I'll go into and show you the source data here in a second. I think I hit the wrong.
Yeah. You hit the connection to the server now.
So, are you sure? No, I'm not sure. Yeah. I want this one. So if I want to test a particular server type, I'll zoom in on this a little bit more so you can see. We have the server types predefined in another CSV file as well. And we've written code to make this dynamic. So I can, you know, hit the server type parameter, and then I can just tab through all the server types. And it isn't as easy as you might think, but it's easier than you might think. So, but Austin wrote a good bit of that code to put this together. So I can then say, I want this server type, you know, space, and then I can tab through and it'll give me, you know, the server types, and I can continue tabbing through that. So everywhere where we allow input of a server type, we have that dynamic driven.
Is Austin here?
Austin is in Salt Lake. He just moved to Salt Lake and he's going to be working remotely for us from there. So he's either going to watch the recording, or I don't know if we're, are we broadcasting live, Oliver? So he may be on live. I just don't know.
Chat hasn't shown him.
Okay. But he's still trying to unpack and all kinds of stuff. So he couldn't find the bolts to his desk this last week after he got there. And, you know, he wasn't sure if he's going to have to buy a new desk just to be able to set it up. So we've been having a little fun with Austin about his move. So anyway, so if I want to check for a particular server type, I can put a server type in there, get the same kind of information. If I put, say, a SQL server, it will only test or show me the requirements for the SQL server. So we should see a lot fewer requirements pop up in our grid now, right? And those are all focused on just what do we require. And since I haven't given it an actual SQL server instance name as an input parameter, it's telling me we're going to check to make sure the default collation sequence on that particular server, whatever that is a certain non-standard SQL Server collation that we require for all of the SQL Server instances where our database is going. And do the server type. I can also do this within the grid if you want to. I don't know if folks have used the grid, but I find this really kind of cool. If I run this command again and I get the grid, I can actually filter and say server type and then add that, and it'll ask me what does it contain, and I can say, you know, SQL, and then it filters it. So you can use this grid pretty dynamically, which I find kind of cool within PowerShell. I had known about it before we started doing all this, but when we started testing this and running this, it was really nice to be able to just run the whole collection and then just filter down the things you want to make sure were right. Okay. And then the other thing is we have a test function. So it will go off on a particular server, and you tell it what version of QNext you want to test for, what server type or types. I want to do a pre-installation test, so I want to see, have I met all of those pre-installation requirements? So I have the right version of the OS? Do I have these DTC settings set correctly? That kind of stuff. And so we can pull that into an object. And it does take a little while because we're collecting a boatload of information. All those classes that you saw that list of, it's actually running through and populating all of those classes or instances of those classes. So it's telling me I didn't provide SQL Server information, so it's going to bypass this check of this requirement, just like the grid told me, hey, I'm going to check this, but I didn't provide an instance name. And so it's giving me that warning message to display. And then it'll also be in the log. So now I can either display all that, and you know, that's great and wonderful. I'm getting all of this information. And what you'll see is there's some extra properties here as to whether it passed or didn't pass, what the actual value was versus the tested value. So if I go through and I look and say, I just want to find the ones that it didn't pass, I can filter that with a where. And now down at the bottom of the screen, I've got just the things that didn't pass. Oops, I'm trying to use the cursor, not the scroll bar. So on this particular machine, I don't have Access Runtime 2016 installed. See this. False, right? And there's a missing value because I just don't have anything installed. It can't tell me whether it's installed with a particular version that's not the one supported or what have you. User account control is not set. The UAC is not set correctly. The private firewall is not enabled on this particular machine. Public firewall is not there. The two desktop folders that are required are not there. And then it also provides some summary level checks. So you can actually run this to test multiple servers in one command. So it'll basically fire this command out to all of the servers you list. Or it can use that persistent server information. You can point to that and say, go test all of the servers that are configured in this persistent server information. And so it'll fire that all out and bring it all back into a collection of objects. And then there's some summary information, one for each server that it tested. That's this particular line, the one up from the bottom. And it just gives us a summary. Did any of the tests fail? Or did all of the tests succeed? And in this particular case, my server has some tests that failed, so I get that summary. And then I get a summary of all servers. So if I tested more than one server, and by default it just tests the server that I'm logged into, if I tested more than one server, it'll scan across all of those servers and give me that final bit of information to say, across all the servers you tested, did any of them fail? Right? And if I want to, I can just execute this just and filter just by those, and I'll just get those two returned to me. Right? And I can get a quick summary across all those servers and figure out whether they meet the requirements or not before I go and do an installation. Sure.
Are you getting that data using WMI or?
It depends on the data that we're trying to get. Sometimes we're using PowerShell, sometimes we're using native PowerShell commandlets, and sometimes we're using WMI to actually go get it. It just depends on what gets us the information at the level of detail that we need to get.
Are you creating custom objects?
Yeah, so all those class files basically are the detail. They're filled in as the detail. For each server, we're getting that collection of objects that are instantiated from those 20-some classes and returning that back. And then it's this test server requirements is actually interrogating every occurrence or every instance of those objects and checking to see what passed or failed based upon what we're testing for on each server.
You mentioned that you're using some open source.
We're not using open source for this stuff, but we're using open source in our actual product. So like Angular is an open source package, right? And so when you use Angular, there's some frameworks and things like that that you use. And we have NuGet packages that we pull in to our build and actually build. Build and whatever we need to actually redistribute, we include in what we package up and get into our MSI installers to redistribute.
Yeah, I was just wondering about your modules. If you use any that are openly available, or are you creating everything from scratch?
Pretty much everything is built by us from our module standpoint. The only thing that isn't built is the things that are generated out of PowerShell Studio for some of the UI stuff. And in essence, it basically embeds that into the PowerShell code that gets packaged up. But it's not looking to the internet to pull anything down. The only thing that you would have to pull down is, depending on the tests, there may be some PowerShell modules that don't come prepackaged with just the default installation of 5.1 that you may need to import from, say, PowerShell Gallery or something like that. And we document those things in the help within a particular function. What those are, and we've actually documented those outside in our installation guide as well.
So you're not using like Presto or nothing?
Not as part of what we would ship to clients and use. We looked at using Presto, trying to implement as a more automated testing tool to build automated testing into this as opposed to manual testing or some other forms of automated testing. We haven't quite figured all out all the things that we need to be able to integrate it with the testing suite that we use to drive the core product testing. But that's something that we're certainly looking at in the future to try to take advantage of Presto and build Presto tests that actually run as part of a regression suite. Okay. Any other questions? So let's see, where was I going to go next? I showed you the utility. Let me just try. I don't know that I tried actually zooming in. Yeah, it doesn't allow me to increase the font size.
Windows key plus will be like a Windows magnifier.
Windows plus.
Yeah.
Well, it puts something up over here on my other screen to bring up a magnifier view.
Yeah.
But
yeah, it's probably within the RDP session then.
Yeah, sure. It's under. And how do I get out of that? That magnifier view. It won't.
Should have some.
It won't let my cursor escape from that.
Alter full. Control
escape
delete.
Yeah.
First little problems, right? Mm-hmm.
I can't even get to a browser window to find out how to get out of the magnifier.
Hold the power button for 4 seconds.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Try doing the magnifier cat command again.
Windows key minus should be that.
Yeah, that shrinks things down within the magnifier window. It didn't actually get rid of the magnifier window.
It possibly the same.
PowerShell execution bypass badwebsite.com.
So that's a good trick to play on somebody at the office is, hey, go do this. And then you can't get out of it. Okay, I got my cursor back, so I'll just I'll continue on. So we can't see the. Oh.
And once you go to the control panel.
Oh, beautiful. I'll suffer through the magnifier showing up.
And disable it in.
Well, if I can get the cursor to actually click in the window, I can't. So
it's probably stuck.
So it said go into control panel and turn it off.
Yeah, I see.
Under accessibility, I assume.
Oh, I'm going to turn off magnifier. Shoot. You can remove it by pressing start, go to control panel, look for the ease of access icon, select optimize visual display. Scroll down the magnifier and check the magnifier selection.
Uncheck the magnifier selection? Or check it. It says start magnifier. Well, that's interesting. It didn't turn it off.
Can you control all escape your task manager and then kill the magnifier?
Maybe I can do that. That's good. Another option.
I think that was covered in the alter full.
Okay, it went away.
Sorry about that.
But now, oh, I know why. Over here, I.
Yeah, program running.
Yeah, I have the window running underneath. Can I shrink this down? Nope.
The alt tab.
It would be an ideal thing if I remember the correct correct key commands within remote desktop. Maybe that was my problem, not the magnifier.
Ammo guns always strike at least once.
Or is this? Fail. Wait a minute. No, that isn't running on the remote desktop. I don't think.
Alt page down.
Alt page down mm-hmm. turns off the magnifier?
No, it's tabs through.
But I don't. This isn't running, I don't think, from.
He's on Windows 7, by the way.
Yeah.
There. Let's get over to a virtual machine. There's we're back to the virtual machine. Right. So what we have in here is we can actually do we can get the server requirements and display them in a grid. We can do pre-installation, post-installation, all of the things you can do from the command line. Set the server type, enter the server. List, you know, the version, all of that kind of stuff. So I don't know if you're interested in that or not, but And then when we do those tests, you know, they should show up in the log. And you really can't see that, but we do have info messages and other messages in there. When the test fails, those kinds of things show up in the log. So. So how do we drive this? Let's go into our modules. So we'll look at one that's a little more simple first. Open Excel. We'll show you this in Excel. So you can see, basically it's just set of columns and rows. So we've got the server type, the short name, a little more extended description that you see actually in the UI, and then even more detailed description of what the server type is. And those are all read in.
Yeah, I had to do it too, so I understand.
Those are all read in at runtime and picked up from the files that are part of the module package that we ship. And so this is pretty straightforward, simple. If we look at the requirements, there it is. Now this is going to be a pretty much a mess looking, because there's a lot of detail in here, but we can go through and you can see how we have, we've got our component name. I screwed myself. I just made the column way wide. So let's do this. Make it so we've got a component name. We've got a regular expression for some of the, how do we test against the particular value that we would expect to be returned when we collect the information. We've got a more user-friendly requirement description. We've got the QNext version, and this is the column in here that is being scanned to create that compatible versions list at the bottom of our QNext version table. So we've got a regular expression showing, hey, this version or series of versions for that version, and then we'll be adding in a 5.60 version, 0.001 for our 5.6 release when we ship that in November. And then we've got the server type column. So which server type or types does this particular requirement apply to? We've got installer types. So each one of our installers, we've made a type for that. And we've got a separate CSV file, so you can tab through those when that's an input parameter. We've got the precondition, right? So schema or SQL Server version. We've got a precondition regular expression. So when we find that the precondition is met, we only test things that apply to that precondition being in place. And then we've got a more English-like precondition description. And then we've defined whether it's a pre-installation check or a post-installation check. And then we've got our reference column out there. And we mostly reference documentation within our own customer support site, but we'll also reference the Microsoft documentation for a particular version or something like that. What we want to do with that eventually is in that UI grid, be able to double click on it or right click on it or something to allow you to just automatically open up a browser session going right to that page. And we prototyped some of that, we just didn't get it in within our release timeframe. Some of the other things we were doing.
Have you tried any other ways to store the data? I was trying to do it through a CLI XML, I think it was. I was outing the object out of PowerShell and then storing it that way and then calling it back as a, but it's, I don't know if that was the proper way to do it. I'm trying to figure out how to take a lot of data and reference it multiple departments in an organization.
I use the JSON utilities. They're better than the XML one because it's easier to manipulate them. Like if you do export JSON somewhere there, I forget the exact command. That's usually what I use. Yeah, that way if I constitute it into an object and then I need to reconstitute it later.
Yeah.
It's easier with JSON.
Just so you can update it, maintain it. Like this, you have to go and add a new row, but you're going to have to add a row probably in the middle here or at the very end, depending on how you want to organize your output, I imagine.
But if there's some reason that you need to keep the intact object type, that you know the CLI XML and the both of those will keep the object types the same. The only time that won't do it is if you have a, if you're calling a web service, the older web service styles, which are the MVC stuff, I think, and you have to do a proxy. If you have to proxy like a class that's out on a MVC class or on a server, if you will, and you have to save those objects off, CLI XML doesn't work very good for it. Because you have to, it's weird.
This is a good example of what I was trying to do. Just lots of information and trying to reference it over and over again. But you have to maintain this, and that's the problem I was kind of worried about with management. I want management to be able to maintain it. And
So we did consider those others, the CLI XML. Mm-hmm. We considered the import and export to JSON. I think there's one other one that was available. And what we're focusing on is ease of maintenance by someone that doesn't know XML, that doesn't know JSON and stuff like that. So we're not even storing this as a CSV object. We're storing it just as a CSV file that was created in Excel. And then that way you can just open up Excel, go and make a change. You don't need to be a programmer to make that change. Anybody could go in with some training, albeit because regular expressions aren't for the faint of heart necessarily, but we're using some very clearly basic regular expressions. We're not getting too complex trying to parse things. So so by and large, we don't necessarily want you to have to go and look up regular expressions and how to create one and all that kind of stuff online to figure it out. So that's why we chose this format for this. Now, for our for the persistent server information, we're actually storing it as JSON and serializing, deserializing that as objects. For the logging, the team that was working on that chose making it a CSV object, basically serializing, deserializing to a CSV object within PowerShell. So, and they had some reasons why on that. It does make it a little easier to read if you just open the file. There's still some extra stuff in there that people who don't understand it will say, what the heck's all this extra crap? But eventually, we're going to probably put those things in other locations. This was just trying to get our first iteration of stuff out the door and make it as simple as possible. We'll probably take the log and put it somewhere in a SQL Server database, because over time, we know that's just going to grow and grow and grow, right? And folks may want to be able to go back and look a year or two ago, hey, when we first installed this, did we run this test? Did it pass? Did it fail? What did it look like then? We also want to build out some dashboards on top of this so that we have documentation on how to create a scheduled task to go and have it run on a server and log whether or not the server meets the configuration requirements still. And you could schedule that every day, every month, every hour, whatever you wanted to. It'll log to the log, and then we want a dashboard to go back in and interrogate those records in the log to show you at this point in time, do we consider that red, yellow, or green, and then drill down into what are the things that make it something other than green, right? Or be able to trend or see over time how many weeks or months has that been all good, and when did we have problems, and when did we fix them, that kind of thing. So there are some larger, more advanced things that we want to do. This is just kind of our first go around it. First building block out the door. Any other questions or feedback, or why did you do it that way kind of thing with this stuff?
So this application didn't really have any PowerShell support you guys created?
Basically, yeah. I mean, we use PowerShell internally to do some of the deployments. We use it to set up some of our VMs, our catalog items, things like that. But we never really required PowerShell or did anything that a client could see with PowerShell. I think, Matt, remember, didn't we use PowerShell to do some custom action with the MSI for one thing at one point in time, maybe a year ago or something? That was the only thing that I remember that we embedded PowerShell on the product.
The client wouldn't have used that. That was embedded in software, yeah.
Yeah. So it's something that we started requiring the clients to install some version of PowerShell probably 6 releases ago, just to kind of get them primed, because we knew we were going to go in that direction and, you know, with something. And then we first introduced it in something that they didn't know. It's all behind the scenes. The MSI runs it. It does a check, or it configures something. We call PowerShell from the MSI and then return back to the MSI. But this is the first full-blown, it's in your face kind of use of PowerShell within our product. And I don't know that any of our other products that we, in our family of products, that use PowerShell in this way.
Okay.
They use it internally to do all of their setup and installations and things like that, automate builds and CI processes and things like that. But as far as I know, no other of our products use this.
So. Now, are you doing some of the debugging and the testing with PowerShell in this project?
In terms of debugging the PowerShell code, or debugging whether it's not something in the product is working correctly?
You know, like maybe, you know, adding a new function or modifying parts of the PowerShell script.
So if we're making a change or trying to analyze a problem that's in the code, we'll debug PowerShell code. Different developers use different things, right? So some use the... Well, nobody really uses the ISC, but most people are using, I think, Visual Studio Code with the add-ins for PowerShell. And there may be some use of Visual Studio with the add-ins for PowerShell to that, too. But by and large, I think most people are using Visual Studio Code.
Pop me in your block. Thank you.
But people who use this, do you require them to use ISC, or do you test it on ISC?
We don't really care what you use, because if it's PowerShell, it's PowerShell. As far as I know, I mean, unless you're pulling in like PowerShell Studio, then you need a license and you need to have that installed for some of the UI development and possibly debugging. But most of our stuff is written in a way that it's vanilla PowerShell. You can use whatever editor that supports maintaining or debugging, stepping through PowerShell code. And we've found some quirks with all of them. You know, ISE really isn't advanced, you know, so you know that. But Visual Studio Code, you know, has some good, great things about it. But there's also some things that maybe don't work as well as the way we want them to work. Visual Studio, you know, every C# developer uses Visual Studio for the most part. You have plugins and things like that. So that's what most of the C# folks are accustomed to, and we can just throw the PowerShell plugins into that and use that if they want to, but it doesn't have some of the things that Visual Studio Code has in it, you know, so just kind of depends on your preference.
So I was asking about your open source, if you're using any freely available tools to use or debug any of that.
Yeah, no, the only thing that we're using is PowerShell Studio, but there used to be a free version, right, Matt Miller? And I don't know if they still offer that, but we've got the paid version, a couple of licenses for that for people that work on that. But again, anything that it produces is actually plain Jane PowerShell. It doesn't require an add-in or anything else to be installed. We wanted our clients to have the most simple, straightforward experience of being able to run our stuff. We don't want you to have to install a bunch of stuff. We don't want you to have to install our product in any way, shape, or form, because we want you to be able to validate when you want to install our product what it is. And so we thought it wasn't much easier than copying the files and and doing an import module. So we tried to keep it as simple as that, so that you didn't need access to the internet, because on our servers internally, we don't have access to free and just unvetted access to the internet, even in our development plan. Our clients probably don't have that on their production servers either. They don't. They protect those servers because they are actually, you know, manipulating and managing and moving protected health information back and forth. And, you know, there's a lot of government requirements around that. And nobody wants to be the one that has caused that to be exposed in some way, shape, or form. So we don't require any internet access from our clients' machines to be able to download stuff. So, you know, when we do NuGet packages, we actually pull the package down and we bake whatever needs to be distributed as part of that NuGet package in our product and distribute it as part of the files that are deployed by our installer, you know, wherever we need to do that. Now, there are some other things that have installers, like, you know, the Visual C++ runtime or the Access runtime, those kinds of things. And we defer to that because over time, Microsoft sometimes changes the rules about what you can or can't redistribute and repackage and deploy for them and how that works. And so we just, hey, client, go off and do this, right? Make it happen before you put our product on there. And it's not to say that if you don't meet all the requirements that our product won't work at all. I mean, our product will work, but you may run into problems. So we're trying to do that validation for you. Yeah. And so I can, you know, the next step is in our process would be to test a server post installation. And I mean, I can go through that. I know we're about at 7:30, and I think people get antsy when we get close to 8 o'clock. So,
and you said that there's a server department that actually manages those servers. Are you doing any installs as part of your validation?
So
the requirements, the pre-check.
So, if you go through the UI of doing an installation, you can check box pre-installation validation or post-installation validation, and it will go through the pre-installation validation first, and then it'll install the product and then do a post-installation validation. Or you can run things, you know, by hand. And in fact, we have, some reason or other, I've lost.
I was just kind of curious about how the VMs get to you. Are they just fresh installs, or you got to install some of them?
We reuse them.
Internally, we reuse them.
They're not a brand new spin up every time. It's just
so you might have some dependency there.
Yeah, so all of our prerequisites for our internal servers are baked into our VMware catalog item. So when those, except for the things that can't be, like BizTalk, you can't install that and then have it spin up in a new instance of a catalog item, right? It just doesn't, BizTalk just doesn't play well that way. So we have everything as much as possible baked into all those requirements about access runtime, DTC setup, you know, firewall setups, all those kinds of things are baked in. For the catalog item, when we provision a catalog item, there's, for different server types, there may be different things that have to happen after that VMware provisioning that takes place. And then we do that manually because we don't create that many servers every year. Once a year, we create new server sets, and maybe we create 20 or 30 servers or something, and then we reuse those. And we snapshot those every sprint, so that if something goes belly up or something gets baked into the product that screws things up, we can go back to a known point in time 3 or 4 weeks ago, and we can restore that snapshot and stuff like that. Some of our other products in the family, they do snapshots and they keep them around longer time, but then they have lots of problems because our security folks, you know, expire the computer account and all that kind of stuff. So all of those AD certificates and stuff that have to be in place go away just because they don't want some old server to be spun up and come into the network that now maybe doesn't meet the requirements. So there's a lot of security actions put in place for that.
So I was wondering too, is that if they're getting updated at least every month, and you have to pre-check?
Yeah, so patches are being pushed out, you know, on every month to the running servers. And all of our servers are running just because. It just makes it easier. We don't have to worry about computers expiring in AD and all that kind of stuff. What we want to get to is we want to get to using Azure, where we basically spin up a new set of servers, you know, provision them through an ARM template, and then do the installation for every build. And then maybe we'll keep that around for 1 or 2 or 3 days, and then we'll throw those away, and we'll have already done 3 or 4 more builds and have 3 or 4 more sets of servers. Because we do run into sometimes things don't maybe uninstall, we've missed something, and our installation changes or uninstallation changes, or somebody puts something in the product, or somebody goes and messes with the server, and you know, we don't want to go have to check everything and find out why something's not working, right? It would be nice to just be able to say, yeah, let's just throw that away. I don't really care about that anymore. Let's build a new one that we know is going to be right. But because of the way we have to manage the internal virtual machines, it doesn't make it easy for us to do that. And so we are actually focused on, as a kind of a medium-term plan, is over the next couple of years, just to migrate all of our QA to Azure and VMs in Azure. And we're a solution partner or something for Azure, so you know, it would be good for us to be able to run, because we can tell our clients, hey, this all works, and here's our experiences, and we'll host you, because we do some hosting of our clients in a certain area. So we could host them in Azure, we could host them in our own data center. You know, costs hopefully will be better in Azure, especially if you're not running your machines 24/7, 365. Like if you have peak times, you may add some app servers, and like open enrollment usually happens towards the end of the year, where companies are re-enrolling everybody, or you're trying to sell to new employers, and so you'll have a bunch, you know, tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of enrollment transactions that all need to take place within a month or two, and then you need to get, you know, bills out for them, the first bills and things like that, so you can start getting revenue. So over that period of time, those 2 or 3 months, you may want to spin up twice as many app servers as what you usually run them. Or maybe there's certain times of the year that you want to spin up a couple extra servers to do some analytical processing or research or something like that. So we want to get to that point, and we want to get to the point where our product easily and will scale dynamically within Azure. So that's our end goal. So we're not investing a whole lot in the on-premise VMware right now, where we know we're going. One thing I didn't talk about is our whole uninstall and install suite. So in addition to all these things to check before and after, we've taken those 8 installers and we've kind of packaged the workflow to actually get them installed in a set of PowerShell commandlets. So we have a PowerShell commandlet for every one of those 8, except for one, because it's a database thing, and we haven't really got a whole lot of database stuff going on from the PowerShell standpoint. So we focused on the product, and that's really only run once across the whole set of servers, as opposed to run on every server. So the bang for the buck and the return on investment isn't there, but we've got some plans to make that happen in the PowerShell environment too. So you can install, run and install for each of the different items. So if we would go and we say git command again, install. So we've got. Oh, I know what I did. I should just do this. Do module next DevOps. Sure. There. Now the autocomplete's working. So there's all of our installers except for one that you can run. So you can run a PowerShell command to run each installer, but these have to be run in a certain order. And sometimes people screw that up, believe it or not. Right, you don't install that often, but sometimes people will screw that. So we've got an install suite that you that will basically run the installers in the right order, and then you can tell it what installers you want to run. So our Q framework is kind of the base framework, the base services. QNext is where our application code is, the web, and things like that. And so we can tell it, hey, install those two components. Here's where you can find the installers that we want you to run. And then here's a file path to where we have our INI files that you can predefine. Here's the answers you give to those MSI installers, right? Or you can run the install suite, and I'll show you an example of this. You can run the install suite without any parameters. So as I've highlighted, it'll run without any parameters, and it will bring up its own UI. And it will drive you through the process of what you want to install. And it will allow you to check and uncheck things. And if something is required that you've checked, you know, like the base, and these are already checked because I've already installed Q Framework and QNext on this particular server. And then over here, it's tough to read, but this first item here is a pre-installation validation. The second item is post-installation validation. You can pick the server type you're trying to do a validation on. And then, like if I want to install this QNext extensions, let's say, I can go to the next, and then it's asking me very similar things that you would provide as input to the command line. And point to where the installer files folder is. You can point to silent install MSI folder there and do an actual silent install so that the dialogues from the installers don't show up over each one. But it'll go through those and show you the progress just like you ran the MSIs by yourself one at a time, right? So we try to give you the very simple experience of point and clicking. We give you the ability to script this stuff out so that you can build your own CD kind of process for testing or whatever the case may be, and build some of our own.
Was it me?
A VPN still up.
Connection still seems good.
Better connect to a different server. Maybe our security folks figured out I was showing things publicly and I shouldn't be or something. So you can do an installation and just say in one command, and we call it internally, we've been calling it the one-click installation. So you just enter a command line, press return, that's your one click. We can do the installation interactively. We also had uninstallation, and you could uninstall things from PowerShell one at a time, or you could uninstall everything, and it would go and do the uninstall right away, because you can screw yourself up if you uninstall the wrong thing at the wrong point. And then we also build into that command the ability to uninstall one thing at a time or uninstall everything that's installed. And so it'll interrogate the registry to find all the things that are QNext related that are in the registry, run the MSI command to do the uninstall in the right order. And then you can also add a reboot command on the end. So once it's done, my practice is always good to reboot after you do an uninstall just to see if there's anything dangling, make sure it gets cleaned up, and it will automatically reboot. So it doesn't look like I'm getting connected back. I was going to show you that. I don't know that it's that fancy or, you know, all that colorful to show, but it's just one line commands that actually do run and uninstall things. And for the most part, it logs as well. And it'll log things into the log file. You go look and see when things have been uninstalled or easily, as opposed to searching through the system event log to find all the MSI executions.
So you showed dynamic parameters earlier that said it automatically populate. Is there any way to reference a dynamic parameter with a second dynamic parameter? What I mean by that is, say, like, let's say that the server needs to be Windows or Linux, and you select Windows, and then based off of that selection, you now have a different set of dynamic parameters. I have not been able to figure that out. Is anybody in here No.
I wrote a chapter in the PowerShell conference book.
Okay.
On dynamic parameters.
And you can do a reference to a previous dynamic parameter?
What I did is I actually, for SCCM, there's a multitude of log files. And so what I did is I did an evoke command and listed the log file names and made those be a dynamic value against the command line I'm calling. There's some weirdness with dynamic parameters when you try to use them. When you actually import a function that has the keyword dynamic parameter in it, for whatever reason, boy, they wrote PowerShell, when you go to debug it, the very first thing it does before bringing in all your functions is step to that dynamic parameter before it does anything. The minute you start typing in something, it will debug right to that dynamic parameter. It's really, really hard to figure out how to get, like, if you look at my chapter, I mean, it's not very big. It's five or six pages, something like that.
What was it called again?
PowerShell conference book. It's out on LeanPub. It's a really good book. There's like 400, 500 chapters in it that about 10 or 12 of us all contributed to.
Crazy.
Yeah.
Great.
Well, thanks. Great. So it just got published last month.
That's very good.
You going to send out maybe a blast to the user group?
I suppose with the link?
Yeah, that'd be great.
I suppose I could.
Yeah, I'm pretty proud.
No, I can't afford to give you guys $60 each or $50 each, whatever it is. So the proceeds for this particular book go to a scholarship program for people that are new to the IT industry, help bootstrap them in to get started. So I'm not getting any proceeds from the book. All goes to a scholarship. So there's some really, really good stuff in there. Like, for those of you that have or haven't messed with your profile very much, there's a guy, Tommy Maynard, if you've met him at the PowerShell Saturdays, he lives down in Phoenix. He wrote a chapter on how to actually synchronize your profile with one or many different systems. Because if you're familiar with VS Code, it has a different profile from what ISC has, from what the command prompt has, from what version 6 has, et cetera, et cetera. Each one has their own profile. And he wrote a module to actually copy it. Anyway, I digest. Sorry, I didn't mean to steal your thunder.
Yeah, good information. So, I can't get reconnected. I tried. I got reconnected for about 30 seconds for some reason or other. The VPN is not happy with me. But
I can tell.
Trust me when I say it makes the installation and the uninstall process a lot simpler. You don't have to babysit the machine. You just fire it off, let it run, and go check the results afterward.
For any of this code that you guys have, some of the frameworks and stuff you've put together in PowerShell, is any of that going to be available like on a GitHub repo or anything like that? Any possibility of any of that?
There's so many things that intertwine with it that's specific to our particular product. Yeah.
Be difficult.
You know, there might be some things that we could pair out, like the dynamic parameter stuff.
Okay.
Maybe some things that would show how it uses the CSV file and that kind of thing. But
I found that the mutex one, that portion of it, that was very interesting.
Yeah.
Because I've always had a problem with open files, and there's actually a guy that tried to recreate all the PS internal tools, and the one I was waiting for, I mean, recreate them in straight up PowerShell, and the one I've been waiting for is handle.exe. I hate having shell out to run handle.exe, and he's got it about, gosh, it must be like 3/4 done.
Yeah, I got it back, I guess. We're almost out of time, so I know. But
anyway,
maybe the write log stuff. We could find a way because it hopefully shouldn't be too proprietary. But I don't know. I might have to ask.
Okay.
Our legal folks, if they understand it.
I understand.
Maybe there's a way we could, rewrite it, so that it wouldn't be considered.
So that'd be more agnostic.
Yeah. maybe take some of the things out that people wouldn't care about, or add some things in. You know, who knows? But yeah. So any other questions? Any
the .NET frameworks, you guys reference it a lot here. What's the best way to learn that? It's like I pretty much when I need to do something, I'll Google it, and I'll pretty much sometimes I'll get .NET references, .NET objects and functions and stuff, and call is that's the best way, or is there just like you guys' experience with C# or just previous coding experience?
Some of us were reading the .NET docs.
Yeah.
People are comfortable and familiar with that. Other folks, you know, didn't start out that way.
Mm-hmm.
And I think usually it's just Google it.
Yeah. Right?
Or, you know, something like that. Is that a fair statement?
There's to that point, there's actually a chapter, as I recall, in that book that's about .NET. Yeah. It's actually like, I can't remember the title of it. It's like sleuthing.NET or something similar to that. Don't quote me.
Yeah.
So, in any case, I did a blog post for all the articles, who wrote all the articles and what their Twitter handle was, if I could find it, on my blog. And then a direct link to the book. Which, if you want my sticker, I got a sticker. PowerShell Posse is my website. Yeah, yeah. I got more if you want more. I got more stickers. I don't know what to do with. I could sticker my face so you couldn't see me. That'd probably be better looking.
Thanks.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I hope everybody's found this useful. And, you know, certainly if there's something you're trying to do or you know, that maybe overlaps with what we've done, I think we'd all be open to helping to answer questions or provide some guidance or show some examples of something that in particular the folks have. But it's certainly been an experience. We couldn't find, you know, a whole lot of examples of doing something like this. The big one that people talk about is the is VMware and their PowerShell modules, and then you've got Microsoft's got PowerShell modules all over the place. And, mm-hmm. and so when we looked to see how should we organize our modules and pull things together, we looked at some of the ways Microsoft did stuff, and we tried to look at some of the things that we could find at VMware. So there may be other examples. There may be better ways to do some of the things we did, but by and large, we had to dream a lot of it up as we went along. And what we found is, you know, by building these CSV files, it makes it very easily extensible. It's just when you need to collect some new piece of information, you've got to either add a property to an existing class, or you've got to add a new class to that server collection. So that's really the brains and the heart and soul of it. And then everything else is just doing comparisons.
Yeah, we should be almost done.
Cool, it's almost 8.
Okay.
I've been here all day.
We'll get you out of here. So, I appreciate everybody's time. Questions were great. Thank you.
Yep. So next month we'll have
Henry Fart.
Yeah, exactly. He's from Holland. Anyway, last time I was here, somebody won the cut. Gosh, he's got a interesting name, to say the least. I'll see if I can remember his name real quick. Anyway, same time, same place, same bat channel, something like that.
Same PowerShell channel.
Yeah, same PowerShell channel. I think we're going to have it the day after Labor Day, unless anybody objects. Because of my schedule, I'm going to have to go back to Texas the middle of September, so it makes it easier for me.
So. Well, with the holiday and stuff, anyway.
Well, it'll be the day after the holiday is when we'll have it this time. I usually don't do that, but I'm going to do it this way this year.
So the 11th?
Be the 4th. Maybe the 4th. Okay. The day after the holiday.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, Brasser. Not under pressure. I can remember. Yeah, Brasser is the guy's name. So, Tom, thanks a bunch. Wealth of good information.
Can't use it now, maybe you can use it later. That's always good.
There's a brown bag video out there that VMware was
one of the VMware guys on to talk about how they create their modules and how it's difficult for them to structure, like how long a command should be. Like I saw one of your commands, how many flags you had.
Yeah.
I was like, wow, that surprised me. But and then they were talking about how like how they tried to reduce those flags as much as possible and add more functions. Yeah, it's just, basically they're replying like there's all different ways you can do it, and
You're not going to satisfy everybody for sure. You just got to pick away.
Make one giant function that does exactly what you need and it has all the options, but then,
All right.